calculate anything at all, okay? And I guess the answer to this question depends on what is really your question. So if your question is doing a prediction ahead of a speed event, sometime maybe your electronic structure calculation is not the right things to do, okay? So what I'm plotting here is a machine learning model to predict Coulomb temperature of ferromagnet. And every point you see here is an experimentally known ferromagnet. There are about 2,500 of them, okay? And as you see, this machine learning model that I don't have any time to describe in detail, predict on average with an accuracy of 80 Kelvin. Okay, 80 Kelvin is better than what you can do from DFT if you don't know the answer. From DFT, you can predict accurate Coulomb temperature only if you know what the Coulomb temperature is. So if your question is, can we predict new magnet, can we predict new Coulomb temperature for magnet, the answer is probably you don't need to do DFT, you need to do something else. Now, I'm going to come back to this point at the very end and try to show that in reality, you need a combination of the traditional high-throughput and methods like machine learning and so on to really achieve knowledge and precision, okay? So the two objectives of this talk are essentially to show that you have an high-throughput strategy to design your magnet, and I'm going to tell you in a second why we pick up magnet, and hopefully that if you're clever, the databases can be augmented with different methods, and sometime you can become hopefully more clever to use it and to construct those. So very, very quickly, as I said, I want to show you that you discover new magnet. Now, there is, if I have to sell this to a funding agency, there is a lot of argument, like you want to do new magnet. There is a big push for diversity in magnetic, in design of magnetic material, because the elements are in supply from area which sometimes are geopolitically not very friendly. Also because a lot of magnets are made by rare earth, so these are expensive. This table, the color is the cost of an element per kilogram. And sometimes you have also new technologies that require to develop magnets that you don't have available at the moment. So there is a lot of reason why you want to develop new magnet. Now, if you scrap all this, the reason why we do that, the magnet is very interesting, okay? And there is two main things that you can think about magnet. So first of all, finding a new magnet is a relatively rare event. So this is an histogram that we put together many years ago where we list any known magnet as a function of the order in temperature. And you see that the magnet that you can use, which means some things that survive well above room temperature, not that many. And in fact, most of them, magnetite, iron, cobalt, and so on, are known since ancient time. And in fact, the earliest magnet I know about, it was reported in a book written in 79 AD by Plinius the Elder. It's the guy that described the eruption of Pompeii, in fact. And he reported magnetite, in fact. So 2,000 years, 2,500 magnet is what we know. So it's not really great throughput, if you think about it. Now, the other thing is magnets sometimes define completely your chemical physical intuition. So if you pick up this perovskite here, this perovskite is a 1,000 Kelvin or so antiferromagnet. And if you look at the chemistry of this perovskite and you look around technetium in the periodic table, you don't find any high-performance magnet at all, in fact. So you find other paramagnet or a very lousy antiferromagnet, or in the case of strontium-rutenite, a very lousy ferromagnet. So somehow this seems to be an anomaly in your chemical physical intuition. So magnetism is define intuition and is rare. So that's why we want to look at it. Now, if this turn, okay. So here what I want to give you is some feeling of how we construct a pipeline to look at new magnet. This was really work done in collaboration with my friend in Duke, Stefano. And so let me very quickly go through the methods. The method was described in this paper some time ago, and more or less is still the same. So essentially, you have three steps to do. First of all, you have to calculate things. So you have to construct libraries of materials, which would include existing materials, so something you know about it, and then library of new one that are constructed according to some criterion that you decide. So, and this is up to you and up to what you want to look for. And what we do here, we use the most probably rock-solid electronic structure method we can think about it. Now, the point is this database grows, so once you start with a method, you're more or less stuck, because otherwise you have to restart from the very beginning. So this is where we are at the moment. You have to put this in a database, and you need a very efficient manager to construct this database, to handle the databases. So this is done in this code, it's called Aflow, developed in Duke. And then this is really the interesting part. Then you have to search. And search means that you have to come up with a criterion to take material on or throw materials away, depending on what you're looking for. So let me very quickly describe these three steps. The first two are the, I'm going to go very, very quickly because many of you might have seen this. First of all, you have to calculate everything that's been made. And if you take one of the crystallographic, probably the most comprehensive crystallographic database, you find about 150,000 inorganic compounds. This is, everything has been very well characterized crystallographically. So that's it. So that's, you can calculate all of those, and you can read what it is. So there's a lot of redundancy, material come many times, because, you know, the same material has been characterized differently over the years. If you remove what is a duplicate, and maybe you add a few more that don't make the database, my kind of assessment is that this number is probably right. So, okay, so that's more or less what has been done. And essentially, we have about 100,000 of them, so we calculate all of those. We left some things out simply because there was no immediate interest to look at those particular materials, not for any other reason. Now, and just want to put this slide on, because this is, of course, is a lot of calculation. So it would make a lot of sense to share this calculation among different partners. So this is a, I think this has grown now, but this was a snapshot of the consortium that was put together by Stefano. And those are people who essentially agreed to share the data. So there's actually not much more behind that to participate to the work program to share the data. So every time I calculate something, I just pass the information to the database. Of course, there are standards. You cannot just do the calculation as you like. So there are standards about convergence, about, many about convergence, about methods to calculate and so on. But then all the data are shared. Now, then you have to construct new libraries for new materials. And then you have to come up with a criterion. So you have to decide how you want to make this library. And what we decide to do is to construct a library of Osler alloys. And the reason for that is, first of all, Osler alloy are this essentially intermetallic compound. If you take four FCC lattices, you interpenetrate it to each other in such a way that you ended up with two tetrahedrally coordinated sides and two octahedrally coordinated sides, you make an Osler. And depending on how you occupy these sites, you have the regular, the half, where you miss one of the tetrahedral occupation, and then you have the inverse, where you mixed the atoms that appear twice in the formula unit, you put one in the tetrahedral, one octahedral coordination. Now, we start from those because experimentally, you can plug elements according to the color code in the various sites, and you have a lot of them. So in ICSD, there are about 2,000. A good assessment tells you that there are probably about 200, and a good assessment tells you that there are about 1,000. So 800 have not been characterized crystallographically well enough to make ICSD, okay? And there are about 80, which are magnetic. So what we thought was, this is a great place to start because we know there are already a lot of magnets. And the reason is simply because you can pick up a lot of those just using element in the 3D part of a periodic table, okay? So what we did was, we construct all the Osler you can make out of all the elements you see in blue. And if you run the combinatorial analysis, you find out that you have about a quarter of a million prototype. If you want to play a little bit with magnetic order and so on, it turned out that we did about 500,000 calculation. So this is a simple calculation, a unicell type of calculation, but you have to do 500,000 of them. So that's I guess that's the good news and the bad news. Then everything goes in the database, and here I don't really want to spend any time because I know near to nothing about it, but essentially the database is stored now in this library. So this is a front end. If you can do a front end search, you get a bunch of property. This is just a crop of what you can get. But of course, it is a back end where you really now do the analysis. So when you calculate things, accessing directly the database. Now, and this is actually where now the interesting part comes. So now you have to find out what we have in the database. So the first question you want to ask, remember, we want to find new magnets, and I want to go back to the experimentalists and ask them to make them, okay? So the first thing I have to ask myself is, can a new magnet be made, okay? And the very first things, the very first thing you have to do is you have to find out the thermodynamics of the new materials. Now, the what I call the zero descriptor is you have to check the enthalpy of formation. If the enthalpy of formation give you a positive number, so the enthalpy of your new material is larger than the enthalpy of the constituent element in your most stable solid phase, then probably there is no go and you can throw the materials away, okay? Now, if you start from that, you start from a quarter of a million, and you find out that you have only 35,000 that pass this first criterion. So 90% of the thing you have calculated essentially goes away, right before you start. And however, there are about 6,000 which are magnetic. Remember, we have about 4,000 magnets. So if I found new 6,000 new, well, that would be a fantastic deal, okay? We will find out it's not quite as that. Now, a much more serious analysis of the thermodynamical stability can be done by constructing the convex hull. So essentially, you have to check whether your prototype decomposes against the stable single element solid phases, but also whether it decomposes, whether it doesn't decompose across all the possible combination of other phases, either binary or ternary. And when you start to do this analysis, then you have to check for all the binary. And for some of the ternary, if you have some of the ternary. And this is, of course, become much more intensive because it means that for every choice of three, you have to construct the convex hull along the two-dimensional edges of your phase space. Now, and then you have to do this, and this is an example of how one of those plots look like. The dots are the one that actually are on the convex hull. And for this particular case, we found that this material seems to be stable according to the convex hull. Now, funny enough, I didn't know about it. This was not in the ICSD, and we predicted stable, and then I find out was reported in some Chinese literature about a year ago. So I consider this as a blind test because I didn't know it existed, okay? Although it existed already. Now, my point essentially is before, so here now, you have to do many more calculations. This is half a million because you have to construct all this binary. So you estimate that you probably need about between 5 and 10 million new calculations to map out the entire convex hull of all those oscillators that we made. So to start with, we decided to look only at the subset of them simply because we have already the binary for those, okay? So then it's something we can carry on the analysis right away. So from now on, I'm going to talk about only a subset of a quarter of a million, these 36,000, that are only the intermetallic, so made of 3, 4, and 5D transition metal. Now, if you do them, what you find out is then you know what is the convex hull stability, okay? So you start from this 36,000, 248 have been predicted stable, only 22 are magnetic. So 36,000 to 22. Now, all those are new, okay? So this is, none of them has been made before. And then if you look at the robustness of this one, which essentially means how stable are from the most stable decomposition, you find out that only 8 are within a KT from the convex hull. So actually, only 8 are something you can probably stand by, okay? Now, if I extrapolate, I can predict about 140. Now we have mapped out the entire database space, and I can tell you that we have about 70, which has been predicted magnetic and stable. Now, if you remember, 80 are the known one. So we predict less than the known one. And if you start to look at the interception between those, what you're going to find is essentially they look more or less like this. So what we have is we predicted correctly about 40 of the known one. We have about 30 or 40 new, but we miss completely about 40 or so of the one that exists, and we predict unstable, and in countries are stable. Now, of those one, I would say about a third are just about the convex half. So any sort of error that you have in your function, any DFT error can swing you across the convex half. Also, of course, we calculate the total energy. We don't calculate the enthalpy. So maybe there are some other contributions that actually can swing you across the convex hull. So those, I would say, are still in the mist. We have about another third, which is between 10 and 50 milliV off of the convex hull. And here you can still save those because we have look only at the very small part of the magnetic phase diagram. So you might have other magnetic configuration that maybe have the ground state and are more stable. But then we find a third which are significantly unstable. So 100 milliV plus above the convex hull. And those probably, these are generally metastable compound that you can predict with by looking at the global stability. I guess what I'm saying is if you accept this metastability criterion, then you have far more than only 130 or so, okay? Now, the final thing we do, we try to predict the thermodynamical quantity, which is the Curie temperature. And for doing this, as I mentioned, doing from DFT, you are very likely to get this wrong, okay? And for the Euler, it's even more problematic because experimentally it's known that the Euler are prone of site disorder. So you start to actually have to messing up with the occupation of a various site, and this affects the Curie temperature. So what we decided to do was the following. We pull off the experimental Curie temperature of all the Euler we know about it, and we try to machine learn a regression, which is actually was a very simple regression, to predict the Curie temperature of the one we didn't know, okay? And it turned out that this regression works spectacularly well with a 50 Kelvin or so accuracy. Okay, so what did we find? So what are these 22? First of all, there are three classes. We found only cobalt 2 and 2 transition metal, manganese 2 and 2 transition metal, or a non-magnetic transition metal, manganese, and another non-magnetic transition metal. We didn't find anything else to be stable. So only these three classes. Now here, what I try to do is to plot everything as a function of everything. You don't need to read this very careful, but I guess what I'm saying here from when you start to plot these things, you find out that something, you start to see pattern in your data. So here, for instance, I'm plotting the magnetic moment per formula unit as a function of the number of valence electron, and you see that the manganese one remain constant. So they seem to be independent of what is the chemical environment. It's just as long as you have manganese in that particular occupation, you have the same moment. Now, if I look closely, essentially, I found three things. First of all, this cobalt 2 magnet, what we found is that the moment scale with the number of valence electrons linearly. This is actually what the regression found. This is more particular for this class, that the Curie temperature also scale linearly with the number of valence electrons. Black dot are experimentally known compound. The red one are the new one we predicted. Now, this is not a great news in the sense that this regression just found the Slayton-Pauling curve, okay? In fact, it's known that, this class of magnet with cobalt 2 actually are on the Slayton-Pauling curve. Now, the only thing I want to stress here, look, we found one, this cobalt 2 manganese titanium, which has a predicted Curie temperature of about 900 Kelvin, because it has a very high valence electron count. So if this is real, that would be a pretty big deal, because as I mentioned, we discovered magnet at very, very low speed, and we found one which is high performing with a very high Curie temperature, okay? So remember this guy. Then we found a second class. This is of this chemical composition. Now here what the regression found essentially is that the TC is depend only essentially on the distance between the two, between the nearest neighbor manganese ion. And in fact, what you can find that are bound by these red curves, so they depend a little bit on a valence count as well. Now, this is in fact, it turned out, is a known thing. So in the 60s, people has developed this curve called the Kasselitz-Konamata curve, which essentially has an empirical curve that people drawn for manganese-containing compound. And And in fact, they depend only on the volume or the manganese-manganese distance. And what we found is that, all our compounds are within those curves. Okay? Now, the interesting part here is because of this formula unit, so you have only one manganese per formula unit, the typical manganese-manganese distance is large. So we're at the very far edge of these curves, the peak at about 3 angstrom or so. So we predicted all those as a pretty lousy Cooley temperature. Now, and this again, this compound having the Cooley temperature depending strongly on the manganese-manganese distance unknown. And in fact, what you can show is that for some of those, you see some of those here, the Cooley temperature scale with the pressure. So if you change the manganese-manganese distance, you change the Cooley temperature. Okay. Now, the final lot that we found is this manganese 2YZ. Now, this is we couldn't predict the Cooley temperature for one simple reason, that all the known one with this composition crystallize in an inverse Eisler structure. All the one we found, these are the known one, all the one we found crystallize in a regular Eisler structure. So we have absolutely no data to do the regression on, so we couldn't predict the Cooley temperature. What we know about those, that these are complex. So here, this is an example, this is my favorite one. It's something we spend a lot of time to characterize, both theoretically and experimentally. This manganese-free gallium is a non-fully compensated antiferromagnet, where you have one sublattice pointing in one direction, one sublattice pointing in the other direction with some canting angle, and the two angular momentum point in another direction as well. So you have a full spin all pointing in different directions. So this is something you can get out of simply high-throughput methods. So it's something that you really have to go with heavy artillery. So this was done by combination of neutron, synchrotron, and DFT. Now, I think I'll skip this in the interest of time. Just let me scroll through a couple of slides. And you're very welcome to ask about those. So this is all very good, right? Does this work? Okay? And there is only one way to prove it. Go to your experimental colleague and ask to grow some of them. And we spend so much time to try to assess the thermodynamic stability because I know that I have only a limited number of shots in my experimental colleague. If I give them materials that cannot grow, at some point they will lose thrust and they will not do it anymore. Okay? So we went then with four compounds and we say, can you try to make those? So we pick up this cobalt 2 manganese titanium and then three of the manganese 2 containing material. So this is what you do. So you go in the lab, you make them. Now, so you make by arc melting. So this is me doing it. Now, of course, nobody believes that this is the way it happened. The way it happened is more like this. So I was watching somebody else doing it. Anyway, so if you go to the lab, this is the result. So cobalt 2 manganese titanium, this was made successfully. It crystallized essentially as predicted with almost an identical lattice constant. As you see, this is the magnetization curve at 300 Kelvin and 4 Kelvin is essentially identical. No hysteresis. This is a cubic compound, so actually there is very, very little magnetic crystalline anisotropy. And this is actually magnetization as a function of temperature. The squid goes up to 700 Kelvin or so, but you extrapolate at 940 against 930 predicted. Now, it's luck, okay? The regression gives you a 50 degree accuracy, but the point is you went from the periodic table to the lab and you can make those materials. So the method seems to work. There is a second case. This is manganese 2 platinum palladium. Now, this turned out, as I said, I don't have a TC for those, but at least was made. Now, it turned out this was made with a twist, so this is a tetragonal distortion that we didn't have. But anyway, now this turned out to be an intriguing one because if you look at the moment as a function of temperature, you find two peaks, so there's two phase transition here, all phase transition between very low moment configuration. So this is a complex magnet. We did quite a lot of analysis, and they look like it's about two ground states, which are all heavy compensated, but all antiferromagnetic. Now, so let me go back to the question just to finish. So I hope I persuade you that yes, you can really have the high throughput and go to the lab eventually. There is a massive effort that goes with it. Okay. However, I hope that as we will
learn how to do these things, we learn to be more clever in selecting the prototype at the beginning, and we'll be more clever to utilize the data for other information.
So we will, the algorithm will be clever, but we need to be more clever than the algorithm.
And finally, these are the people who did the job, people in my team and people in Stefano's team. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Stefano.